Okay, thank you so much, Chris. Okay. Greetings and thanks for coming out, you guys. Do any of you know of my husband, Kalindi Iyi? No? Just one person in here? Okay, so what I do, okay, two people. As I keep in the fashion of my African culture, I greet my husband's spirit as he walks with me and journeys with me on these different trips that I'm on, these journeys that I come to and I speak. So I will greet him and welcome him into this space with me right now. And as I say, Igun, Mojuba, Ibaye, Ashe, Ashe, Ashe O. Igun means ancestor. Mojuba means greetings. Ibaye means respect. So when I call his name, I will say Ibaye, or if I call the name of an ancestor like Maria Sabina, I'll say Ibaye, meaning respect. And I'm just acknowledging the power and energy of my ancestors, okay? Okay. Now I've got some crazy notes here. And I say crazy because they're all over the place, right? So hang in there with me. And I just want to start with a quote by my husband. And promise me when you Google him, you'll thank me later, okay? Absolutely. So the quote is, "The most important thing I think I've discovered with psilocybin is that we are not hooked to the body. There's no end, there's no death. Consciousness goes on and it's a trip and an exploration." Those were his words shortly before he passed. I knew intrinsically that he knew intrinsically that he was making his way out of here. I believe that he, because he explored mushrooms at a high dose, 50 grams max at one time, that he stepped into a place that no humans probably didn't have the privilege to be in, right? He's seen things that the regular, ordinary human just did not see on a 50-gram journey. He didn't take 50 grams to say, let me see how much I can take, how far I can go, or my ego, or to test anybody else. That was not his goal. Specifically, he went in at 40 because he was trying to save the life of a woman that he loved very much. She was my co-wife. Her name is Kai Wingo. She had fell into a coma. And he decided, because she was a high doser herself, that she was in a space in that coma that was very familiar to her, and she got comfortable. Because if you've taken higher doses, you kind of realize that, you know, your consciousness has detached from this human body and you're someplace else. So I believe that he believed that she was comfortable in that space, but he wasn't ready for her to go. So he went in at 40 grams to see if he could reach her in that space. Instead, she reached him, because he got stuck. He was thrown into a puzzle, he said. And she came forth in that space and offered him a hand to pull him out. Now, at first it was his ego was like, no, I'm here to save you. And she's like, no, I'm here to save you. And so she pulled him out. She did pass, right? And but he, from that point, he decided that in seeing what he's seen over there at 40 grams, he decided that, let me go in at 50 to see how much more I can do inside of this space. So Baba would take, and I say Baba respectfully, that is father, head of household, or the most respected one. I'll call him from this point going forward Baba. He would stand in front of a mirror. Now everybody know how bad mushrooms taste. Some people say they taste like, sunflower seeds. No, they don't. Oh my God, right? So we got all kind of ways of taking now, chocolate, lemon tech. You know, we take it with honey, you know, different ways to get it down. But the cost of the price of the ticket to go really far in that space is to fast all day and then take them dry. And you gotta be a G, you gotta be a warrior to do that. So Baba would take, he would stand in front of a mirror. I don't know what the mirror was about. But he would grab a handful and just put them in his mouth, and he would chew. and chew and chew, and oh my God, I'm getting sick just thinking about it. And I'm like, I'm getting a hotel room, I'm backing up out of here. Because I knew that his journey was going to be that plus some. He didn't talk a lot about those deep, deep journeys, except for this 150 gram journey. He was told that maybe sort of an energy like, do you all remember the movie Doctor Strange? And do you remember the energy, the Dormammu energy? It was sort of kind of like that, the way he was explaining that this energy said, I will give you everything that you thought you desired on the planet Earth. I will give you all the women, all the money, all the things, whatever, but you just have to bow to me. And he said it was never tempting to him, because if there's a God worth serving, then you don't serve that God. You just don't serve a God. You don't give yourself over. And so he said, absolutely not. Now, I'm not saying that that's the reason why he died, but 2 years later, he was gone to us. I just come back from Oakland, California, where the day of his death was April the 10th, this past April, May 2 years. I just come back from Oakland, California, where we commemorated April the 10th as National High Dose Day in honor of Baba Kalindi Iyi. So it is, and going forth from this day forward, that will be considered National High Dose Day. Now, am I telling you all to go at 50, to go at 40, go at 30? No, I'm not saying that to you at all. But I'm just saying that on your journeys, be aware that incrementally, as you move up, or maybe stay in a place where you're more comfortable at in doing the psilocybin, that there is work every time you take it a step up, a step further. I have no desire to do 50 grams of mushrooms, none. And so I'm not gonna do that. It is my mission to assist in creating an alternate reality of openness that we can bring to life together. A life where we can evolve with and without, within and without, towards becoming one with cosmic energies, nature, consciousness, and each other. As well as offering a place where caring for each other and our world is as important as our love and deep respect for all of Mother Earth's creatures. As a divine group of individuals, we open ourselves up to share, to care, express, connect, to recreate and heal, to unify as well as beautify this planet that we're on. I give thanks. I first took my my first dosage of psilocybin 22 years ago, and my first dose was 5 grams. It was my husband who offered this to me. He said, here, take this. I'm like, but what is it? He said, it's mushrooms. I'm like, can I get some dip with it or something? What do I do? What? I had no idea what was, you know, he didn't give me any kind of education or anything. It was just like, take this. So I took the 5 grams, and okay, that changed the entire trajectory of my life because of this 5 gram journey that I took 22 years ago that I had no knowledge of where I was going. But what did happen is that I went back through my mother's womb. Went back through my mother's womb. I remember going into a fetal position, going back through my mother's womb, and I landed in the pyramids. And the reason why I know that that was there because of the glyphs that were all around me, and they were very familiar to me. I could read them, but I just couldn't. It's just, I knew I was in a place that I'd been before. And I felt like at that moment, had I had more of these mushrooms that I've never taken before, that I would really be able to read what I was seeing. So back in the day when we were taking them, we didn't call them medicine. I come from a place where we were explorers. We were adventurers of the multiverse. My husband and I, we were galactic gangsters. We would get on our psychedelic motorcycles and we would ride through the cosmos, and we would hang out in different planetary spaces. And just, you know, we was on a mission here to see what was out there. It's so much more out there. So my husband's words were always, be more than what you are. Go deeper. Then as we move forward and you know, up into this, we found that people were beginning to understand a different way of living as they took these journeys. And I started going in for people to assist them in a healing modality. I had a young woman come to me who had all type of womb issues. And I said, well, let me go in at 7 grams, 7, 8 grams for you, and just to see what I can find out about what happened to that space in your womb. Because a lot of times when we do mushrooms now, that's where women connect at if they're in a circle, it's through the womb. I go in, and there's an ovary in this hand and an ovary in this hand. And these ovaries are spinning, and stuff is just flying off of the ovaries. And I'm looking at what's going on here, and I'm like in this space. But unbeknownst to me, there was a healing taking place in this young woman. 2 or 3 days later, she asked me, what did you do? I didn't do anything. I just went into that space of triple black darkness. I gave the intent to the mushrooms, and I'm going to talk about intent a little further. I gave the intent to the mushrooms that this is what I wanted to do, and it led me to her ovaries, which was the problem. But anyway, it helped her. Now, that was empowering in and of itself to know that without touching her, that I was able to go into that space, and that the mushrooms, the psilocybin, heard my intentions and took me to that place of healing, which started this whole thing for us in terms of healing. My Bible would say, stop going in for everybody else. Let them do their own work, you know, and he was absolutely right. I was able to assist, but I also needed them to do their own work. People, we have lived in a society that promotes fear, and they know that through that fear they have gained control and power over us. And that biggest fear is growing old and dying. It's like when you get to a certain age, you're supposed to sit down, grow old. As I say, watch reruns of Andy Griffith over and over and over. My particular one is Bewitched Up, but you know, anyway. And wait for death to come. So I want to read this portion from the Essence of Buddha. Stay with me. A large proportion of human suffering occurs because people think that they only live once. However, when they become fully aware that their present life is only one point in the eternal flow of time, and that they have lived in the past and will live again in the future, they will understand that their future lives will depend on their present life, that their future lives will depend on their present life, and also that they can choose what kind of life they will live in the future. Does that make sense to you all? Mm-hmm. Did you feel where I was going with that thing? That how you're living now, mm-hmm. what you bring into this life now as you leave up out of here, is how that future life will be. This is taken from the Essence of Buddha. As people grow older, again, they are experiencing the pain of loss. They may be a grieving widow. I should be somewhere sitting in a corner, biting my nails, scared of what's coming next. You know, I've watched my husband die. He died in my arms. And it wasn't very pretty at all. But I can tell you that through psilocybin, put me in a mindset of understanding the depths of what death really is. Now, I'm not saying let's go home and be happy to die. No, that ain't where I'm coming from. But I'm just saying, if you can relax the fear in your life and in your heart about this next phase of your journey and enjoy what you're doing now and make your life better now, don't sit and be anxietized. Okay, so the kids don't call you every day. You know, you may have lost your husband or your wife, and now you're alone. Okay, so you got 5 cats, your old cat lady or whatever, you know, but look at it as golden. Step outside of yourself and enjoy what life has to offer you. We've been given a beautiful planet, and through the eyes of psilocybin, you'll be able to see that beauty. But yes, also, you'll be able to feel the hurt, but you'll be able to balance it out. And when I say see the beauty of what's on this planet, just for example, a blue sky, a green tree against the blue sky, a red bird in the green tree against the blue sky. That shit gets me off. I love that, and I give thanks for that, and I honor that. I have no religion. That if I had a religion, it would be the moon and the stars and the earth and the water and the air and the fire. Those would be the things that I would honor as my religion. But when we can look through the eyes of psilocybin and just, we all have a story. I've heard some incredible stories of psilocybin success, though. Psilocybin success, where we have come into our fullness, even after the trials that we go through as warriors, and we can stand and talk about it, that means that we are on our path to success. So changing the way that you think is a very important part. And so what does psychedelic mean? It means mind manifesting. Mind manifesting. People hear the word hallucinogenic or hallucinogens, and what do they think? Oh, they tripping, they getting high, they hippies from back in the day. This is what they do. Hallucinogenic means to wander through your own mind. They say we use 10% of our brain, the other lies dormant. Well, what psilocybin does is unlock that door so that you can step into that side of your brain and get to know where this soul that is encompassing this body right now has traveled through the multiverse. We're not just one-dimensional beings, right? This soul that has encompassed this body has been through 300, 400, 500 years of reincarnation, and it has experienced some of the energies that you will come across even in different terrains. This soul has been to other places in the galaxy. How do I know that? Psilocybin has told me that. I've gone to these places that have been familiar to me, different terrains. And you know it's a stranger terrain. You know it's an alien terrain. Alien. We've been gifted psilocybin on this planet. It is 460 million years older than any other spore or plant ever. And it's a gift to us. It has been on the planet for thousands. From the beginning, it was uncovered back then, but put back to sleep. Why is it resurging now? I'm excited about the renaissance of psilocybin, or entheogens rather. Let me stop here. Entheogen means to generate the God within. To generate the God within. So I'm excited about knowing what we possess on the inside. And that we're utilizing it now, because you know why it's the way it's way it is right now? We need help. We are in trouble as a people. Look at what's happening in Ukraine. The earth doesn't want this. She's feeling the pain of all of this loss. Our world is not a world where we need to go at war in order to obtain a piece of land. That's back when we didn't have this mind manifesting energy to show us another way out of this thing. But here we are. It has been dropped in the hands of man, and I'm not about to put you men down. Not at all. But y'all done fucked up. Look what we've been left with. It has fallen into the laps of women to make a change now. And it's not because we are standing up so high that we're putting you down. We're just bringing it up to a level where we can create a balance, to where we can heal the planet and heal one another in relationships, and then therefore the children would be healed. Because we got to stop what we're doing right now. And I know that through this work that has been secret and therefore sacred, it is my job to keep it sacred, because of the powerful work that can be done through the usage of psilocybin or entheogens. Bufotold, dimethyltryptamine. Let me stop at dimethyltryptamine for a minute. DMT, 5-MeO, is endogenous to the body. When a woman gives birth vaginally, her vagina secretes DMT as the child is coming through the vaginal canal. This child is lucky to get some of this energy. Some of us come out psychic. We seers, we're empaths. We get deeper energies of, we have vivid dreams. That comes from that squeeze of that vagina that's giving the dimethyltryptamine to that infant as they go forward, because they're gonna need it. Especially us women, we've been given like an extra 2 cupfuls or something, because we just have to be that way, you know? We gotta chase after the kids. We gotta make sure everything is okay. We gotta protect and provide, nurture and educate, because our men are doing other things. which I don't think a lot of them understand right now, because right now they're chasing that dollar. You know, yeah, we got to have it to eat. Of course we do. Pay the bills. Of course we do. But look at the unbelievable greed that's coming from the dollar. When I read the paper, or read the paper, who does that? You do that. Oh, geez, that's what we do. And I see these Russian oligarchs, as they call them, billions and billions of dollars with yachts and jets and homes and all of the things that they have. If you don't have your health, what good is all of that? If you're not in a right state of mind, what good is all of that? There's a tremendous ugly energy on the planet, and we as women and men collectively, as we create the balance, we're gonna fix all of this. You know, it's coming to an end. I believe that the patriarchal energy ushered out in 2012 during the winter solstice, and the matriarchal energy was ushered in. And it's a humongous responsibility, sisters. So stand in your game, pull up your big girl panties, throw your shoulders back, push them boobs up, handle it, become the warriors that you were put here to be, and speak your truth in honesty and in reverence and respect for yourself and all others. I want to explain a little bit so you can know a little bit more about me, though. I am called High Crone Warrior Priestess, Mama Ayana Iyi. High because I've been elevated by my society, by my community. High because I be high a lot, but no, that's not for real, y'all. Only at night. I gorilla glue my ass to the couch and I'm done, so. But no, High Crone because I've got this type of respect in my community now. Crone, the triple goddess energy, maiden, mother, crone. That is the three cycles of being a woman. Okay, so I'm in my crone phase now. I'm a maiden young woman doing my thing, you know, as a mother, loving my children, being a wife, working, doing what I have to do. So the blood flows. It flows, the energy flows from me in order to keep it going, and it builds back up and it flows out again as I prepare my body for another child. So mother, crone. When you say the word or you see the word crone, what image comes to your mind? She's bent over, she got a hook nose, she got a hump in her back. She's kind of like this. This is the crone image. Crone is the corrupt version for the word crown. Now that I no longer bleed, I wear my crown proudly because now my wisdom is inside and I can bring it forth. I can bring it forth. Now I don't need to run around after the children. I'm the grand mother, and I am. And so that energy is just, you know, high crone. I've done my work, and I'm ready to guide and lead and bless you. Warrior, yes, I've been through some stuff. I've been through some stuff, and I'm still here to stand and talk about it. Still here to stand and talk about it. Still here to stand and talk about it. We, as warriors, we have to wear that title proudly, because as women, we go through some stuff. But we keep standing when standing is just sometimes too damn hard. But we get up and we get it done. Priestess, I can bless you. I can bless you because I've got this energy from all the great mothers before me who stand and hold me up as I sit on their shoulders, or they have their hands on my back collectively, and I can bless you, and those blessings can generally come forth if you're coming to me with a pure heart. My heart is pure and open to each and every one of you. I am a Scorpio. I am the sister of Oya. Oya is the deity that sits at the gates of the cemetery. She is a Yoruba deity. I say that because in my work through psilocybin, and when I take my journeys, they take me to a place of here's life, here's death, and I go into that in-between space right there. Always, I'm always seeing dead people. I'm always seeing people who are going to die. I tend to know what's gonna happen through birth and death. Okay, but why are you giving me this? What do I do with it if I can't change the fact that somebody is, why do I need to know somebody is gonna die and I can't stop this from happening? I still don't have the answer to that, but that's where it will take me inside of that place. And so I kind of eased up a little bit because it was getting a little heavy, you know, seeing all six of my mother's sisters before they died, knowing that they were going to die, in which I was able to say to my mother, Mom, I need you to come and see your sister here or your sister there, or your sister there. They're getting ready to die. Unbeknownst at that time, my mother was looking at me side-eyed like, you must be a demon. God is the only person who knows when somebody is supposed to die. How are you going to know this? How could I explain to my 80-year-old mom that I take mushrooms, Ma, and I go to another place in time and it delivers this information to me. But I was able to see this energy and able to connect with it in order to, I guess, help them cross over, help take them to a place in the fifth dimension where the souls hang out, where souls are a lot more comfortable at. There are so many souls on this planet right now, as opposed to human bodies. They are looking for hosts. People can become stepped into, and I'm not talking about those, oh, she's so wonderful now that she's died and she was a real bitch when she was alive. No. You a bitch on, you know what? When you die, if you a bitch here, you a bitch there. And you can get stuck. And these people, this energy can step into those of us because you know why? Because of fear. Because of people who are being anxietized about anything. Because people who drink too much. Because people who are liars and cheaters, people who are on drugs, that's when these entities can step into us and create havoc in our lives. There are so many people with entities inside of them because of their low-level energy. These things find hosts and they will wreak havoc. Let's say you and I liked each other. But not really. I can't stand you, and you can't stand me. But your entity has recognized my entity, and that's what hooks us up. And we get together, and we bitch, and we fight, and we cry, and we moan, and we kick each other. But those entities would not allow us to be apart from one another because they're doing exactly what they've been set here to do, which was wreak havoc in a human life. Taking your psilocybin, or your other method of entheogens, ayahuasca, Bufo told again, can help you see and reveal to you that these things are inside of you and you can help move them on. It's called a spiritual hygiene to move this stuff on so that you can live a better life, especially as you grow older. Where I stand as an elder in psychedelics, I'm both excited and disturbed. The excitement is because of the psychedelic renaissance. Mother Nature is assisting us so that we can assist her. I'm excited that we are moving away from the side effect laden pharmaceuticals that only put the mind to sleep. One in five, and I'm going to use women, one in five women are on psychotropic drugs. They give us abnormal drugs to cope because we live in an abnormal civilized society. So they give us this and they tell you, go home and be better, but yet come back in 30 days to get some more and some more and some more and some more. So you become a forever patient. It only feeds big pharma and it's also dulling your mind. And like you said, sister, you take this one, sort of fix this one and so on and so forth. And now you got a bag full of pills. And some people wear that bag full of pills like a badge of honor that they got all of these pills to take. And then they have the audacity to tell you, maybe you should only drink it with a sip of water. So you got all of this garbage inside of you right now that's dulling your senses. So, and along with psychotropics, anti-anxiety, Paxil, Zoloft, Xanax, Valium. Young girl said, I said, Denise, what does it feel like to be on Valium? She says, well, here's an example. If my 7-year-old said, Mom, I'm about to jump out the 9-story building, I'm about to jump out the window, she would say, okay, sweetie, just take a sweater with you. She said, that was what it was like for her to be on Valium. Just sleep, and I don't give a damn. Whatever is happening, I'm away from it. I'm not dealing with it. We've been afraid to deal with what comes from, you know, this world that we live in. The images that are constantly coming through on our phones, constantly telling you how many people have died, who's been raped, the war that's going on. You're constantly bombarded with a lot of net. Now, I'm not knocking social media. It has done what it does, but it's also doing more than what it should. So it's now become a mind fuck. And you've got to have the discipline to not listen to those bells, those little beeps, those little tones, those little lights, because what do when we hear them? We're trying to see what we done missed here. Miss that shit. Cut it off, put it in a drawer somewhere, at least take a day off. Once a week, take a day off from that phone. I promise you, when you cut the phone off and put it away, there's a sense of peace that comes over you. Because you know you're not gonna be bothered with no dumb shit, right? It's just a sense of peace, and I let my children know. I'm turning the phone off. If you really need me, call the other phone. And if you call the other phone, I know that you're in trouble. But today I'm shutting this down because we're being bombarded. And that's for a reason, to keep your focus away from what it is, which is yourself. Psilocybin puts you in a place where you start to deal with self and the energy of self and what it is that you need as an individual to move forward. So I'm excited that microdosing has become a part of a lot of people's lives. I started to microdose simply because I didn't think I needed it. I was like, well, you know, I want to sell it, so I want to talk about it so I can be honest about what it is that I'm saying. But then I realized my biggest peeve was driving. Somebody would cut in front of me. I'm like, you can't drive. And nobody could hear that crap but me. I'm getting agitated over something that I couldn't control, but I'm agitated now, right? Found out through psilocybin, after taking it maybe a couple of weeks, because it's cumulative, took it for to kick in. Oh, you want to get in front of me? Come on. You too? Everybody can get in front, and I'll just drive and be okay about it. I was cooled out, and I was like, okay, who is this? My husband would come into the kitchen, and so here's the counter, refrigerator here, and the garbage on the side. He would drink the juice or whatever and leave it right on the damn counter, when all he had to do was pivot and toss it into the trash. But he would leave it on the counter each and every damn time. I would get livid about something so simple. But then I started to be like, let me just throw this away. He said, baby, you need to take four of these a day because you just turned into somebody. I don't, I become a professional nag and didn't realize it, right? You know, well, y'all know the honey do this thing. Y'all know what I'm talking about. I got a spell for you all ladies. At the end of this, I do identify as a witch, and I got some really good spells for your husband, man. So remind me to tell you that. So anyway, how many in here have done mushrooms?
Yeah.
Okay, that's the majority of the room. How many have not? How many have not? Okay. So I'm not here to tell you any horror stories about taking the mushrooms, because there are some pretty powerful things that people are talking about. But what I do want to push through to you is that, again, it's endogenous to your body. You cannot over D or OOD on this. It has to be an LD fit. You have to eat your weight in mushrooms before it, you know what I'm saying? It's just not going to harm you that way. It doesn't stay in the bloodstream maybe no more than 24 to maybe not even 48 hours, but you will still get that energy as flashbacks come to your brain. We have a protocol that we set forth many years ago, which is the 5, 7, and 9 protocol. You take 5 grams first, 7 grams, and then 9 grams, each time with a sitter, a gatekeeper is what we would call them. The 5 grams permits visual acuity. If I were on 5 grams now, there wouldn't be a ceiling right here. There would be no lights on. You all would start to disappear around me. There would just be me in triple black darkness. The lights and the colors would be hitting the serotonin receptor sites of the brain, and I would be taken to another space and time. But basically, I'm still kind of earthbound, but that's your first journey as 5 grams. 7 grams, we call that an aphrodisiac dose. 7 grams generally causes CNSA, central nervous system arousal. The man will get an agitation and an erection, and the woman will get the energy in her vagina, and it's like, you know, let's get busy on 7, you know. And I can guarantee you, couples that get busy on 7 grams together, You're not getting busy, you're creating magic. Sex is magic, sex is sacred. Look how they've demonized sex. Ooh, you know, they've turned it into something, an ugly, horrible thing. Yeah, I don't need to get into all of that because y'all know where I'm going with that. So 7 grams creates the energy of, it's called henosis. H-E-N-O-I-S, henosis. That means becoming one flesh. You're connected in a space that only psilocybin can put you in, and you become this energetic, magical portal of two people sharing a space so sacred and ancient that what can we do with that? We create another human being from that. We've been created from an energy so powerful. So what I'm telling these women today is to go in at 7. Make a baby at 7, because we're bringing forth children now that are coming through. They want to call them pandemic babies. I don't like that word. But these babies that are coming through specifically, that where the moms have taken mushrooms as a child is in utero, taking mushrooms during childbirth and delivery, taking mushrooms by breastfeeding, these children are amazing children. My granddaughter, who is now 7, will be 7 in June, was a mushroom baby. Her mother took 2-3 grams when she was just maybe 2 months pregnant, when all of that stuff was splitting and turning and doing what it does in order to make what we do was coming about. And now this child, she was with us the last time I was here in Ann Arbor. She's an amazing child. When my husband passed, you know, she was just turning 4 years old. And she seen me, you know, sitting, looking out the window, tears streaming. And she said, "Don't worry, Umi, they're just rebuilding him." You know, now this is coming from the mouth of a child. She also says, Umi, she was sitting coloring one day, and she says, she looks up and she says, "You know Baba is still teaching, right?" And I said, "Well, how do you know that?" She said, "Because he whispers in everybody's ear." And I suppose that he was whispering in her ear at the time. But she has the mind of a engineer. She can take things apart and put them back together again. And I'm not gonna go on and on and on, because I could break out my phone and we could be here all day and I'll show you pictures of my grandbaby and that could be the end of that, so. But I'm just saying, was she gonna be this magnificent without mushrooms? Of course she was. But mushrooms enhanced. And so I wanna go into that place of enhancement and what psilocybin will do. As a martial artist, my husband was the martial artist for many, many years. You know, he was a master at what he did. And of course, you know, having a husband that's a martial artist, I'm gonna be trained in the martial arts. But there were times that I would come to class and he would do a move and I was like, "Can you do that 25 more times so I can get it?" You know, I take the mushrooms, again, the word intent. I open my bag and I'm like, "Look, I know that there is a latent martial artist and somewhere inside of this, in my experience, because I love it too much. I can get it half the time, but I need to get it immediately." And I give that over to the mushrooms. I do my journey. It, you know, it shows me some moves, I guess. And then it takes me wherever the hell else it wants to take me, of course. But I go back to class in the next couple of days. My husband does a sophisticated move. I can see it. The science, the beauty, the energy is just right there in front of me. And I get it. And I flip this great big dude. Just like that. Because I got it. So, enhancing who you are. If you are a massage therapist, do I have any in the room? Massage therapist, you can see the meridian lines. You can just look at the body and tell. Musicians, the notes, we know that notes are galactic. Music is galactic. It comes from another whole part of the galaxy. When you think about what a musical note is and a musical instrument, you have to know that this is something that's otherworldly. But through psilocybin, and you are the musician, those notes just start to do something different for you. You know, anything that you do and you want to do better, psilocybin will only enhance that for you. You don't have to take these big journeys. I encourage that you do. But if you just want a microdose on a daily basis, it will just bring you into a place of calmness. If you watch these programs on television with nature, you really see where we're at as far as nature is concerned. The colors, the energy, what the insects are saying. You can sit at the water and listen to the language of the water and understand it. You become connected to Mother Earth, and it's such a beautiful energy. I'm so excited about that. So microdosing and your trips is very important to your lifestyle and your life as you move forward. I'm excited that many people are beginning to step outside the boxes of religion and the fear it promotes and are seeking spirituality from the entheogenic point of view. My mama told me, she said, you're gonna burn, you're gonna fail at everything that you do, and you're probably a demon spawn. I don't know where I got you from. She called me up and she said, I don't want you in my home, I don't want you in my life, and I don't want you in my world anymore. I was devastated. My mama, it was my mother who gave me my power, because she taught me to live by the courage of my convictions. And I knew that she was coming from a place of religion, that if I don't plead the blood of Jesus, I don't even know, what do that mean? I don't know how to do that. But she said, if you don't plead the blood of Jesus, then there's nothing that we can do together evermore. I could have lied to my mother and, you know, walked falsely, and said, okay, mama, I just wanna be with you. But I was like, deuces, mom, if this is what you wanna do, then I gotta go. Because she is the one that taught me, stick to the courage of your convictions. And I was convicted in what I believed in. And I knew that what she believed in was because of her generation, and that she was getting older, and she was scared of dying, and that she wanted to go sit with Jesus. And that's how this whole thing works. You know, they just flip you over. And I refused to do that. My mother had a massive stroke. Maybe 8 months later. I didn't see her for 8 entire months. She had a massive stroke, and when she opened her eyes up and she seen me there and she could recognize me, she said, can you ever forgive me? I told her I never held it against her, because I knew what it was that she was trying to do for me from her point of view. And I sat at her bedside for the next 8 months, because she gave me back those 8 months almost to the day before she died. But 2 months before she died, she opened her eyes again and she said, you know what? I think you know more about this religious stuff than I do. I was able to help my mother open her heart before she made her final journey. My mother was able to see me as who I really am, and not a demon spawn, but as this wondrous, glorious, powerful woman that she helped create. And I seen the in her eyes that she recognized who I was, and that was the sole purpose of me choosing her as a parent this time around. They say we choose our parents. I don't know if you all believe that or not, but we have lessons for them and they have lessons for us. And my lesson for her was to open her heart to all that is, and not just be told some bullshit that they tell you. We got to be prepared to understand that everything that we've been taught has been wrong. Because mushrooms will strip away the world of illusion for you. It'll start to help you move certain people out of your life that shouldn't be there. You start to see the energies, the illusion of money. We chasing the bag, we chasing the bag. We never have enough money. I don't have enough money, so I'm not gonna have a kid. I don't have enough money until I can do this. We don't have the time to do that. So the illusion has been created that you gotta get it. The more you chase it, the more elusive money becomes to you. I say to you, don't stress, but manifest. That again, mind manifesting. We can create this thing. Is it gonna be the millions that we wrote down on our little paper, like I want 5 million? No, it's not gonna be that. But what's going to happen is that there's a constant flow to where you're able to handle your business. When you give from your heart and not expect anything in return, it will come back to you, and it's just reciprocal. That's what this is. Money is an illusion, and it creates fear of those that don't have it. Another way to suppress your immune system is, of course, through fear. I was talking about spirituality, okay. Well, you know, I tend to do that, so stay with me as I roll throughout this talk here. I'm disturbed that was once secret and sacred is now being exploited, which brings me to the word integrity. In some psychedelic circles, people are doing questionable things. They're selling psychedelics as if it's weed now. You know what I'm saying? It's like, I'm gonna put a hit on that, I'm gonna sell it for this, and I don't care what I'm selling, and it can have substrate all over it. They could be done thrown spores, they're dirty, they're nasty, I'm just gonna sell it because I want this money. They're not responsible to find out if this person is on psychotropic drugs, or that have they ever taken a journey before? Have they set forth a protocol? All they're doing is thinking about money. You got people that take 3.5 grams and all of a sudden they're a damn guru. Listen to what I'm saying. I'm here. I know what I'm talking about. You don't need to listen to nobody but me. I got my card. Everybody got a card now that I'm the psilocybin, I'm the mother mushroom, I'm this, that, and the third. Vet these people. You're putting your life in. You don't know who's growing and how they're growing and what their house look like and whether their lab is clean. You don't know if the cat done pissed on, you don't know these things, you know? But you will know through your use of psilocybin, because what does it do? It helps to open up that third eye. And you can start to feel who you're dealing with. And that's why I don't particularly do slides, because you know what I want y'all to do? I don't want y'all to see the pictures that I got. Everybody got a picture, and I'm not knocking that. But I want you to feel me when I talk to you. I want you to get inside of this place with me, because it's just that deep, you know, so that we can connect on that place right there. So dealing with the people that are lacking integrity, you start to recognize, because there's an energy that comes across you. It's like, nah. You know, something not right here. Ask questions. Ask questions to people that you know. Now, this woman has a ton of products out here, and they look all fantastic. And I'm going to buy some of this stuff, absolutely. Because you know what? I could feel the energy of it. If it was questionable, I wouldn't even took a look at it, right? Honor. This beautiful, divine technology is here right now in abundance because it's here to help. It's Mother Earth's way of saving her children. I'm 67 years old. I'll be 68 this year. And for the past 20-something years, I've been taking psychedelics. And I say to the women in my particular age group, the women that are alone, as I am a widow now, when you take your psilocybin, look in that mirror, butt naked, and look in that mirror until a goddess looks back at you. Because see, through psilocybin, you have revealed your true self. I'm a beautiful, strong black woman, and I'm holding it down. And I don't look at them, well, I'm 67 and I can't do this no more and I'm going to sit myself down. Be fabulous. Now, is it an overnight fix? No, I've been doing it for 20 years. So you're not going to be as fabulous as me if you haven't been doing it for 20 years. I'm just saying. No. But my energy is that of any 35-year-old woman out here. That is the energy that I possess. Now, I'm looking at all the subtle and not so subtle signs of aging, but I'm okay with that. Boobs are gone south. You know, mom's apron is here because I done gave birth. You know, and I look in the mirror and I love what I see. I'm honored by what I see because I look through different eyes. I look through a spiritual eye. I look at who I really am as a woman, and I'm glorious. And I'm really happy to have walked this planet as a woman. And hopefully when I go and come back, I'll come back as a woman again, because I've done my hard work. Y'all know that when you pass on and you come back as a woman, you've done your work. But if you got to come back as a man, I'm just saying, and I keep looking at you for some reason. Let me look at somebody else. When you come back as a man and you swinging and them balls hitting you and you got to move them to the side all the time and you got to be bothered with, and you got to wake up dealing with where I'm going to get laid at. That's what y'all wake up. That's first thing on your mind. 777 times a day you're thinking about doing it to somebody. Come on. So you elevate when you come back as a woman. I'm just saying, be lucky and come back as a woman. So deep, complete respect for something so magical, so mystical, and so accessible to us through rituals and the use of crystals and stones, nature's bones. We want to utilize nature's tools as we go into that space. I wear these, are called Yiming Zhus. If you were to cut out all of the lights in this space right now, this would be glowing green and this would be glowing purple. Okay? These are Yi means you. Yi, night, bright, light. Yi means you. They're quantum computers. When you take your psilocybin, if you're on maybe a 5-6 gram journey, and your stones are all the way on the other side of the room, they just start to, and you get up, they're beckoning you to bring them forth and take the, you know, on the trip with you, and they just open up the pathways to dimensions a lot better, and you're able to go into a place that you wouldn't be able to go into. We call it the interdimensional village. When you go in with your stones, when we use our transdimensional crystals to go into. I have at my home, and maybe I will start doing slides so that you can see some of the things that I have at my home that we utilize as we go into that space. It's a huge crystal that takes 3 men to move. It's called the Palantir, and we go in at 21 grams, and it imparts the energy because this stone is millions and millions and millions of years old. It's been in the ground for so many years, and now we brought it up, and now it allows you to see the history of where we come from and where this stone has been when you do 21 grams in front of this stone. So using tools to go in helps. That's for the more advanced psychonaut to go in, because you had to have at least done 15 in order to sit before the Palantir at 21. So utilizing these types of energies, these pretty diamonds and rubies and emeralds, and they're all to adorn the body, but do they really tell you what they really are for? I wear rubies in my ears that darken when evil threatens. It will darken on this side if the male energy is evil. On this side, my left, if the female energy is evil. Now, do I walk around, are you dark today? No, that's not what's happening. They start to itch. They bother me. And I'm like, okay, let me see what's up. Let me take it out, and it's really dark. Then I know that I got to protect myself from something. It allows me to be alert. It's like a phone call to me. I need you to step up your game. Pay attention. The energy is male, and it's coming from that direction. Pay attention, and it has not failed me yet. Understand that it's just not here, nature's bones, to ornate the body. It's energy. And so, as you know, they got these stones that's going on right now, and everybody got a stone. You should have a medicine bag with your stones inside of that. Women in particular who feel like they are threatened by something should take that medicine bag, and if you do wear a bra, pin it to your bra under your left arm here so that energy can give you an area of protection. But inside your medicine bag, because you have decalcified your third eye by doing your work, you'll know exactly what to put into that bag for protection of yourself, okay? This is the stuff that comes from taking a 5 gram journey, a 7 gram journey, a 9 gram journey, or if you decide not that you don't want to go through that because you are older now, just go ahead on and microdose every day or every other day. It just changes who we are, and we're able to see where we're at on a regular basis. And it's not so damn scary when you can really see where you're at for real, because they make sure that it's scary. Look at, what is it, World News Tonight? Oh my God. They go around the world in 30 minutes and everything is like, and they always try to end the last 2 minutes of something good. After they done bombarded you with all of this horrible stuff, they want to end the last 2 minutes with, oh, and this is what happened today. Well, it's a noble gesture, but come on. So, reverence. Through rituals and the use of our crystals, it's like a door has been opened to those who decide to walk through. Utilize the energy that's been put forth you and seek it out. So ethics comes to play here. Ethics inside of, again, we spoke about that earlier, about people who are selling things that are not quite up to snuff, you know, they're no longer being ethical because now money has taken over. And with the decriminalization of entheogens now, oh boy, look at what's happening now, okay? You know, it's all over the place. You know, again, everybody has a card. Everybody is a professional. I've been taking this for 20-something years. I still consider myself a novice. Every time you go in, the journey is a different journey. Sometimes we can connect the dots, but it's like you're still always, always, always learning, and you have to be humble enough to give thanks for the fungi, not to try to control it, because you cannot do that. And when you speak, you have to speak with conviction because you've educated yourself. There's a lot of studies out there now, a lot of data that's being collected. John Hopkins University has been doing a lot of this study in the past years. I understand, where's that young man who has the book? Is that you right there? Who talked about PTSD with veterans. And the government is looking at psilocybin as a tool. Are you familiar with the Rising Consciousness community? No, 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 just that I was just invited to come to San Francisco to speak with the veterans on behalf of psilocybin, and I was very excited when the guy told me. I was like, so veterans are being introduced to this now, you know, so I want to know more about what it is that you know. Are you a veteran? Okay, okay, so that's just a powerful thing in itself because, you know, post-traumatic stress, of course, is a deal. I should, again, watching my husband pass like that, me trying to do CPR on him, me blowing in his, you know, come on, baby, don't leave me. Come on. You know what I'm saying? It was just very traumatic. So I did have some post-traumatic stress, and I noticed that when I would watch television and watch somebody die. It was like, oh, it would hit me in a different way now that I've lost my husband. But again, through my usage and from him whispering in my ear, you know, when I feel it, I let it come up and I let it come out, you know, because all of the things that we gather through life, we store inside of us, but we got to be able to get it out. And mushrooms, ayahuasca, DMT, Bufo told will help you get it out, because this life is meant to be lived, and it's meant to be lived in a healthy, honorable way, so that when you love somebody, you love somebody. And if you love somebody, you always love that somebody. But if the vibration is not where it used to be, then you'll recognize that it's time to, I love you, but I can't live with you. I love you, I can't live with you, and so therefore I'm not gonna hate you because of it. It's just that now I recognize that now it's time for us to do this. So many people are dishonoring one another when the relationship is over. They're angry, and that's for a reason. Wake up, everybody. We can wake up the planet. And that's what it's here for, to wake us up. Children are being fed this stuff, these phones, these tablets, this virtual education, because I don't have my phone. So we're looking at our phones like this. What is that right here? My pineal gland, my third eye energy. That's where that phone is hitting, that right there. The TV is there to stop, to calcify the third eye so that you don't see the spiritual energy around you. There's magic all around you all the time. But if you're, and they know that. So they design these little contraptions so that it will emit that energy to that third eye, shut it down, so that you'll only listen and see what it is that they want you to see and listen. That's the trick. Cut that stuff off at night. Take a whole day away from it. So I've worked diligently with those who are, who you know, to decriminalize. Now we're decriminalizing the state of Michigan now. And we have our volunteers that have come forward and are helping us do the work here. Is a sister right here. I don't know if you all know the name Julie Barron, but she's done an amazing job here in Ann Arbor. She and I was just in Utah together doing the work there. We're continuing the work. So basically in decriminalizing, how dare you tell me that I can't expand my consciousness, but I can go get me a fifth of Hennessy and get drunk and fall the hell out and it'd be okay with that? How can you tell me that I can't think better and higher of myself because of this beautiful fungi? Because you want to keep me like this with your knee on my neck, pushing psychotropic drugs down my throat. It's enough that we got to pay these damn bills every 30 days without clockwork. The headache come. That's enough to stress you out. Trust me, everything that they put forth for us has been to frustrate us. We're living in a world of frustration. I'm saying free yourself, and especially now that we're getting older, and as we're looking out in the world as an elder now, we're wiser. What can you give your young people as you sit in this place of elderhood? It should be wisdom and reverence for your ancestors, and to take better care of your body, to eat foods on a higher vibration. And if we're lucky enough at our age to still be having sex, yes. Yes. Well, we spoke about the intent, the responsibilities that you have if you are a grower. Do I have any growers in here? Yeah, my growers? Mm-hmm. Yep. Growers have to have a particular energy when they grow. If you feeling effed up that day, don't go in there and handle your stuff. Don't do that. You want to be at a place of peace when you deal with that, because you take on a symbiotic relationship with your growth. They want to be you. They allow you to be them. But while you're doing this interchange and you're working and you're growing, you don't want to go in there with a bad attitude or this shit, I got to do this today. You don't want to do that with your mind. This is sacred energy that you're dealing with. You know, so you want to at least know that your grower has got it together some. To where when you do receive this sacred energy from them, you know that your purchase is the purchase of somebody who is grounded, who's in a good place inside of their head. You know, now with the way that it's going now, it's going to be a little hard to do. That's why I say exercise your third eye, exercise what you feel as an individual, and don't ever, ever, ever second guess yourself. That is your own personal power, is your intuition. Don't second guess. If something says don't, then you dadgum don't do it. A lot of times, I'm going to do it anyway. And you mess up every time, right? Y'all know. Mm-hmm. Entheogens are cosmic gifts to support and restore the galactic brain power. And each and every one of us must go forth in assisting in elevating the consciousness of this planet. And so it is. And we have a responsibility to each and every one of us and to our children and our children's children to leave this planet in such a way that we've at least done the work. We provided the energy and the knowledge for it to carry on in such a way, because peace is obtainable. Racism can be eradicated. I mean, I've got three police officers in a state in the South, I won't name Mississippi, that are microdosing. They keep their edge, right? You know, they gotta get out here and they gotta handle this stuff. But they don't shoot somebody nine times in the back just because, you know, pow, 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 pow. And then I'm gonna ask, they don't do that. If I had my way, and hopefully one day I will before I get up out of here, all law enforcement, that would be a protocol where they have to microdose. This is just to be a part of their training and everyday life so that they can handle their business in an effective way. So perhaps maybe that's something that we could push forward in the future. So again, I say to you, go forth, talk to your people, talk to your children. Daughters, if you're doing mushrooms, go to your mom and them, your grandmom and them, and say, look, let me sit down and have a conversation with you, because now that it's been decriminalized, maybe you'll listen with a different ear now, because, oh, it's against the law, so I'm not gonna do that. Oh, we can go to jail. I got something for you, mom, grandma, grandpa, I got something for y'all that will really help take you from this place where Andy Griffith won't be so exciting to watch every damn day, right? You know, you wanna get out and do some stuff and hang out and enjoy what the divine creatures has put forth before us. Do you all have any questions for me? Oh wait, don't ask no questions right now. Okay, so I want to share with you another energy that I got from my journey. I'm laying in the bed fighting this COVID thing, right? I'm like, damn, it's gonna take me out of here. What's up? You know, I can't breathe. But I remember, and I don't remember consciously, but I started to hum the tone B flat. This was just coming, you know, I don't know if that was helping me breathe or what, but the tone B flat started to emit from me many years ago on one of my journeys. And I remember each and every journey that I've taken over a 20-year period. On this particular journey, it told me that if I was ever in war or I was fighting an enemy, that the tone B flat would be my greatest weapon. That was years ago. So I'm laying in this bed fighting this COVID fever. Can't get up, can't breathe. And I didn't know at that time, but I just recently found that out, B flat is a form of sound therapy that brings the cells to its healthiest state, especially when practiced on a regular basis. I mean, goddamn, really? Like an ohm, yeah, but at the tone of B flat, right? And it just, and it brought my body back up. It helped bring my body back up. So the messages that you get from your journeys, it's not, oh, I just had a hell of a trip and it was the bomb. What do you bring back and how does it enhance your life today in this 3D dimension? What can it do for you right now as we move throughout our day? Not that, oh, damn, I can't wait to do another 12. No, what is it? Make it work for you here and now and whatnot. Listen to the language of the water. Your plants talk to you. Yo, you're a little tardy with the water, right? You know, nature. You'll save a life. You don't step on ants anymore just because. You know, you have a reverence for what's going on around you. And it's a beautiful thing when you can look at life and smile at it and not grimace at it. Thank you.
What was that spell you're going to tell us?
I'm sorry.
What was the spell you were
going to give? Oh, right. Okay. Not a question. So, if you have a man that is not very domestically inclined, right? My husband told me when we first got together, he said, I'm an intellectual. I'm not domestic. I was like, watch this. You get a pair of his boxers. Now, they have to be boxers and not tidy whities. You get a pair of his boxers and you fold them towards yourself. Every time you fold, they're being folded towards yourself, okay? You fold them up enough, and then you take those underwear and you stick them in a mason jar, tie it on, and you put it up in the kitchen cabinet, back in the cabinet, someday I'm wearing the dark. You'll come home, sweeping. Honey, I'll do the dishes. What you need, what you got, we're not trying to turn you on to slaves. We just want you to take out the garbage so that it don't be all stacked up against the wall. You know what I'm saying? So that helps domesticate your man a little bit more because you just captured that energy, put it up in it, helps. Yeah, okay.
I have a question for you on that. What happens when they find the underwear up in the
They cupboard? Never find them.
so
men don't really look that, they're not that thorough.
This is one thing I wanted to say about the elderly community that I learned like from the Chaldeans and that urban people.
Okay.
I do the plumbing a lot. You know?
Okay, yeah.
I was a master plumber, so I'd go into their houses. And what I noticed in the Asian people too, they've always respected their elders. Like they take
yes.
them, yeah, the Polish people too, but like
yeah.
more than any other culture I've seen.
Absolutely.
They all live in the same house.
Mm-hmm.
And then the grandparents are like the godfathers of the house. Like everyone was like, so the other parents, like the Kelvans, the reason why they have so much money is because there's like six or eight of them living in the same house,
yeah.
all the older boys, you know, 40,
yeah.
50 year olds with the kids and the mom or the grandparents are taking care of the kids while they're out working. And then, and like, because they usually don't let too many people in their house.
Okay.
Go in their house, and like, when you go in their house looks like a store in the basement.
Wow.
And they told me because, like, where they're from, they had brought in a drought and famine and
That's
stuff
right.
like that. And so they would usually prepare for a year or two just in case, you know what I mean? And so I really honored that culture because all of them, like the Asian people, because I watched how in each situation, how they were respected. The older people weren't put into nursing homes like white people usually
yeah.
with their families.
Yeah, and forget about them.
Yeah.
Yeah,
they take the knowledge and the wisdom because they have those grandparents have lived a whole lifetime.
That's right.
And they have all this information that we don't have.
That's right.
You know? And then on top of it, they're educating the children.
That's right.
You know what I mean? They're giving the children the energy that the parents don't have, the grandchildren.
Divine
the
wisdom
that don't
and
have.
Those
yeah,
babies
the
are
parents
listening.
Out there doing
yeah.
the crap that they're doing.
That's right.
And so I feel that America has totally lost that culture, especially.
America never had that culture.
Well, they did. Look at Detroit. Detroit had all those big houses. All those families used to live in Detroit.
I'm talking about in terms of their elders and not putting them away
but
in
they,
homes.
But Detroit at one point, you know, because I caught the end of it.
Okay.
You know, I caught that because you can still see some of the families that live together. You know what I mean? All those big houses, like the aunts, the uncles, the whole family, the whole clan used to live there. You
yeah,
know,
well, communal
up,
living was
yeah,
a deal then,
put,
because it was
E-way,
called.
Up until they did the riots and put that E-way right through there, that was like a structure
yeah.
in our, like Detroit was probably one of the greatest cities in the world because we put
I
the
agree.
World on wheels.
Yeah.
And we were one of the first areas that started showing how you can make your own money for
mm-hmm.
the country.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like New York is always good, Chicago is always good, but Detroit was the place that put the world
it
on
was
wheels.
America.
Everyone came to the Midwest.
Yeah, we were the Paris of the Midwest, exactly. Yeah.
Did you say the Paris of the Midwest?
That's what Detroit was called.
Is that right?
Yeah. It was called the Paris of the Midwest. That's why everything's named after France. You know, that.
Detroit and
Well,
we've got a question over here.
Yeah, we
took it. I love Detroit.
Yeah,
we took it.
We're bringing it back.
I just mean the family, like where I see the senior stuff going. I feel that the seniors are huge.
Yeah,
like, they're the community. Like,
people are looking at seniors now like they're a bother. Like, you know, I got to take care of you now, and I don't have time for this because I got to be on my phone looking at some stuff that don't matter. But I got to go in here and give you your medicine or change your diaper or whatever. Look, I called for another 40 years for my life, as long as you don't have to change my diaper and wipe drool. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? And I plan on being that, kicking it up. Absolutely. But you're right. I agree. Reverence for the ancestors. Yes, ma'am.
One question. You mentioned about 5, 7, and 9.
Mm-hmm.
How about 9? Because I've done
I didn't
five.
Do 9, did I? 9 imparts the mysteries. 9 is where you start to galactically move about. You start to go forward. And so it's very important, and thank you for bringing that up. It's very important that your gatekeeper, the person who sits with you during that journey, is not in the room with you, hugging you, holding your hand, wiping your brow, because you're staying earthbound because of their energy, you know? So at the 9, the mysteries are imparted. You actually begin to galactically leave this place for real. I had to learn to sage my hair before I went on these journeys at a higher amount, because my hair kept me earthbound because of all of the energy that's inside of it. So I would sage that. But what I would turn into, and I hear it from other people, is liquid. I would morph into this liquid energy, and the way that I got around was through tubes. These hollow glass-like looking crystal-like tubes is the way I traveled in these journeys. And then when they dropped me off into whatever space they wanted to drop me off into, I would come into some sort of form, or I could see where I was at and what I was doing. And then when it was time to take me further, I morph back into that energy and go back through those tubes. So the 9 is the mysteries that are imparted. And you're kind of ready for that after 5 and 7, because now you kind of got a feel for who you are, or how you are, or how you react to these different things on this journey. But your sitter has got to be someone who is experienced, because some of us do get in trouble out there. Mm-hmm. Trouble meaning, I mean, I've had stuff come to me, this just nuts, about a mouth with teeth in it, you know. And if I succumb to that energy, it's like, you know, I'm on a bad trip right now, you know, but you face it, because whatever this is, it's something that's been inside of me that's coming up and coming out, and it's like, I dare you to move me on. Be brave enough to move. And that's where your sitter comes in. If they hear you in that space, they know to come in and get you, to bring you into the light, because the light can be a diffuser. But they also know that when you're calm enough, they got to put you back into the dark by yourself. The best way to do these journeys, 5, 7, and 9, is alone, in the dark, and butt naked. So, you know, if you have a sitter that you trust, because women should sit with women, men should sit with men. Again, I love you, my brothers, but if a left titty hits you in the face the wrong way, you're going to be like, damn, look at that love titty. No, that's not where we're at on side of this thing. You know, sex has nothing to do with it. I'm very candid, and I hope that I'm not embarrassing you. Okay, so I'm looking at this. She's like, oh, my God, what's she saying? But it's the truth, okay? So taking care of yourself in that space, your sitter has to be an experienced person. But, yes, you get to travel, and then when you go, your 12s and your 15s and your 18s, incrementally we're going up. I would never tell you to take 9 and then 221. That would be irresponsible of me, because this is not ready for that. It's like anything else. It has its methods in the way that you do them. So, yes, thank you for that. Yes. Mm-hmm. Anybody else?
Do I have to have all the 9?
Here, you want to? It's for the record. So if it's a great question, which it will be, we'll have it on there.
Maybe, maybe not. Is it? We're on.
It's good.
Oh, okay. I'm new to this.
Okay.
So what's the difference between microdosing and a high level? Do you want to start with small increments and then go to a high level, or?
Well, I say to people who are microdosing first and have never experienced a journey of 5, 7, or 9, mm-hmm. that they may have to go higher on their first larger dosage, because the body has already recognized the psilocybin. It's inside of you. Mm-hmm. So you might need more in order to obtain where it is you're going. So I wouldn't say start with that, mm-hmm. unless this is where you want to be at and you're working on something in particular, like levels of anxiety or fear or, you know, I mean, paranoid, schizophrenia, I mean, bipolar, all of the stuff that we as humans got going on. But I would suggest, you know, I see people that are now starting at 3.5. I'm not trying to knock anybody that's taking smaller doses. Your dose is designed for you. Mm-hmm. I just know that I started out at 5, and it blew my world and my mind, but it blew my world and my mind in a really good way. And so I'm not knocking you if you start at 3.5. I'm just saying go on and knock it up to 5. What do you got to lose here? You knock it up to 5 and then you hold on to the floor. And you enjoy your journey, you know?
Superman dose or something? I've heard people call it the hero dose, the 5.
Well, that's what Terrence McKenna coined, was the 5. That was it for him, you know?
Yeah, because I would take about 2.8 or something and get real good, because after about just me in general, because I when it happened to me, like when I took a good amount, like it turned into like Interview with a Vampire, where the statues had eyes, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
The television came alive. I mean, I think because we had a pound of them, so we picked up the best mushrooms out of the pound, me and my buddy, and we ate them.
Turn the lights out.
Yeah.
Put the phone away. Why you got the TV on?
This was like 20 years ago.
Okay, because he didn't have protocols set for it.
This was
right.
Like before. You the only way you can get these was the Grateful Dead.
Yeah, right. So you're doing it as a recreational energy.
Yeah.
You know, you want to go and have fun on this thing.
It was just one of those things where it's first time you ever had them. No one explained it to you. You didn't have anything like this going on. Hey, you take this much or you can do this. It's like, you heard your buddies go to the Grateful Dead thing and talk about these mushrooms, like, yeah, bring some of those things back, you know, and it's like, and you want this experience, you know, or you want to try it, because you know, we did the acid before, and the acid was just too, you know,
it's man-made, we're dealing with something
and
that's
then, like,
completely
so the
natural.
Mushrooms, you really want to go toward that direction, and then you just don't have any guidance. I mean, think about it, you took yours, what, 20 years ago?
Yeah, and my I trusted my husband, mm-hmm. I mean, I felt like he probably would have said, well, this might happen or that might happen, but he gave me no indications of what could possibly happen.
We didn't know what was going to happen.
Know?
Like,
but I was with my husband, and I trusted him, and I wasn't around a crowd of people to where that person that I'm looking at has morphed into this monster, you know, shape-shifting and shit, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It's like, oh my God, where am I at? Help me. We've had people take them that didn't listen to the protocol that would go to the hospital.
Oh yeah, yeah.
And what would they do? They put you in the psych ward for 72 hours with a hold on you, right?
Yeah.
Because you done lost your straight mind talking
werewolves
and stuff coming at you, yeah.
Yeah, because that's what happened to me, so up until, I was like, what the hell? So we unplugged the TV's still on. And then my buddy takes off.
Wait a minute, you say you unplugged TV, and the TV's still on?
I haven't had a TV since. So.
Okay. Yes, sweetie, I'm sorry.
You're good? No. No, you get the microphone.
Okay, so the next question that I have is the difference between the different entogens. Like, there's so many different types.
So the 5 grams will...
no matter of the type? Meaning, the different characterizations or the different types. So, like, she was telling me, there's like the golden teacher or the.
So, the different strains of mushrooms.
The different strains. Okay.
The different strains. Okay. Well, there's so many strains now, and they're naming them so many wonderful things, just like marijuana, and you know, I've only tried a few of them. Okay.
Okay.
Which is Penis Envy, my husband's own strain.
We call it PE now. We do not use that word. We call it P.E.
Why not, though?
Because it's sexual?
Because it's sexual, and we don't have black market. We've done away with underground market. We call it the rainbow market now.
Y'all know them damn penis envies on fat and thick, and y'all know. You're playing. You know, it's like, damn, this one.
Okay. Still tell me the names of the ones that you've tried.
Gold Teachers, Gallantol, mm-hmm. Burma. Mm-hmm. You know, Burma is a particular favorite of mine because it takes me into the womb space. Mm-hmm. I take a group of women every year or every other year up mm-hmm. into the woods. Mm-hmm. And the group that I take up there is called Sisters of the Sacred Black. It's not because of the color of our skin. Mm-hmm. It's because of the triple black darkness of our wombs. Mm-hmm. And so we sit in a circle in ritual, because it's very ancient for women to gather in nature, in ritual, and do our work. Mm-hmm. That's where we create our magic in order to start the healing process for our sisters mm-hmm. and for the planet. And I promise you that the earth requires blood. It's sacred that your blood will hit this earth before you leave this particular energy. So the different ones. Burma is the one that I would suggest for womb work. Mm-hmm. Golden Teachers, again, is, you know, you take your amount. It's spiritual, but it can be a little easier on you than PE.
Penis envy.
When they came up, they wasn't talking about envy. They wasn't talking about us envying no penis. It's this. That's like this little fat thing. Oh my God! Come on, guys, y'all. We are not gonna do this to make you comfortable. Just not gonna do it. We've been doing this for years to make y'all comfortable with some stuff. It ain't happening. No. Okay. So you can try your different ones depending on, you know, I can't tell you, well, you have a high level anxiety, you need to take this one. Mm-hmm. I can't tell you that. I'm not versed on that because, again, each journey is specific for you and your physiology, you know, the type of strain that you take. Talk to the person that you're purchasing. We have Tamarian Blue, my husband's own strain, and it takes you right in there. It's no gradual way up. You just go in. And that's the same way he taught his martial arts class. You know, he taught masters and he taught beginners, but he all taught them the same thing at the same time. So it's like you take it and you hit with a bucket of cold water, you're going to get hit. You know, so it's just, you know, you're in there. So I took some Mezatepec. Mezatepec was a very soft energy. After my husband died, I rented a hotel room and I took about 8 grams of Mezatepec. And I felt him hold me and console me and comfort me and rock me, and it was just a very soft energy of, and there was information coming in, and it's just, it's okay, baby, don't lay in this grief, it's all right, come on in, and I love you. And it was just, the love was pure and beautiful, you know. So it's where your head is at as well when you go in, which is again where intent comes in. You know, you breathe your intent into that bag, you inhale the energy of the mushrooms, and as you eat, it's a sacred, and try not to hear some nasty shit, because that's what you want to say, but you want to, you know, you want it to be like, okay, I'm going to eat this, you know. It take me a whole hour to eat a 5 gram bag, you know, it's incredible. So don't get one stuck in your tooth. Okay.
Thank you.
One last one.
I just want to say, number one, I've so enjoyed listening to you, and thank you for sharing your wisdom.
Thank you.
So a couple years ago when I first started, I had two separate doses of 5 milligrams.
Okay.
And both with no reaction, other than a stomach ache.
Hmm.
So fast forward a year later, enter Bufo Toad, and then I went to another 4 milligram dose, and I had a reaction. Anything in your experience that you could speak to why that would have happened?
No.
In the strands, they were strong. Yeah.
You know, I just had this question just the other day. She called me and she said the lady had no experience at 5. I said, none. She said, did she get sleepy? Did she yawn a lot? Did she laugh? Nothing. I don't have the answer for that. Again, your physiology, do you take more and more until you get to, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It's like, which is why I said that perhaps maybe our 5-7-9 protocol should change to maybe higher as we start, because now we're being bombarded with so much stuff from our phones and our TV and information that this brain of ours is holding on to so much content until it's kind of hard to get through some of that. Mm-hmm. And that again, lights out. Clothes off.
Yeah.
Don't eat that day. You find people, I gotta eat something because I'm hungry. Be a warrior. Mm-hmm. You know, do the journey the way the journey was meant to go in. Mm-hmm. Even the little pin light from your TV over in the corner is too much light. Mm-hmm. It's distracting.
Yeah.
You know, and then you go in and you release it. You just let it take you. You know, you said you felt absolutely nothing.
I mean, I had a tummy ache. You know, I was kind of tired. But then after my experience with BUFO, I had a couple experiences with BUFO, all that changed.
So the BUFO is what opened you up.
The BUFO was like opened me up. I felt like something just like here just opened.
Okay.
And it was, it's night and day difference now.
Oh, that's fantastic. Yeah. That you did go further though.
Yeah.
And I guess the energy was like, I need to go further. And you did. BUFO is not for everybody, but it's for everybody.
Mm-hmm.
The toad will call you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You'll want to seek more information. BUFO alvarius means mm-hmm. belonging to the womb. It's an energetic thing for women specifically, again, because it's a nurturing energy, but it also detaches you, you know, your consciousness yep. from this body, and you're out there.
Mm-hmm. Totally.
You're totally out there. So for it to move the block that you probably had, that's fantastic that you went there.
Yep.
I applaud
Thank you
for that. A lot of people are not brave enough to do the BUFO.
Thank you.
Yeah, because that's a, there are no words
One more.
In the human language to define or describe a BUFO journey. There's just no words. You just have to go there. So it removed grief from my body, you know, hold on to the grief from my loss of my mother and my sisters and my brother right back to back to back. It's like, damn, y'all lifting up out of here. How much am I supposed to take? I miss you guys. My grief was somewhere, but I wasn't wearing it, but it was there. And when I came from my BUFO journey, it was gone. And I knew that that's what it was. That was gone. It was just a lighter lifting. It was lifted. Yes.
My question, I heard you speak a couple months ago, and you talked about a trip that you were taking down to Mexico.
Yes.
And are there spaces still open in there?
Yes, there
and can
are.
You talk about that a little bit?
Yes, my husband, since 2016, would take a group of people on the ultimate entheogenic journey in the mountains of Oaxaca, Mexico. Mm-hmm. And this mountain is a sacred mountain. It's where the landslide mushrooms go. They're called derumbes. And they're sacred is because they have been hit by the lightning. The lightning strikes this particular mountain here in Mexico, and this mountain is 10,000 feet above sea level. So when we do get to Oaxaca, when we get to Huatuco, we then have to travel another hour and a half, 45 minutes, straight up to be in this mountain. And this is where, are you all familiar with Maria Sabina?
Mm-hmm.
Does that name ring a bell? Maria yes. Sabina, this is where her descendants live, okay? Maybe 40 miles from where we're at with the San Jose del Pacifico. So we take the people there for the ultimate entheogenic journey. We do the toad in the morning on an empty stomach. And then in the evening, we do the landslide mushrooms, which is about 21 to 22 grams. But we drink the elixir, is what we do. I would suggest that you go ahead on and eat the sludge from the mushrooms after you drink it. But, you know, I don't push that person because I'm not eating it, okay? So, but, I mean, I have my shaman there who is doing the work with you. And it's just the ultimate because you're doing them both in the same day. It's a three-day journey. It's all-inclusive. You only have to get your way there and back, but everything else is taken care of for you. We live in a beautiful place. It's rugged and rural, but it's beautiful right there in the hills. And you do your BUFO, if the weather is permits, out in the forest on the beautiful land where the fairies hang out at. I promise you, you may see a fairy or two, and that's without the BUFO. They just kind of come out. Yeah, absolutely. So we do this once a year.
When is it?
This is June 23rd through the 26th. It's $1,300 to go. If you are interested, I do have 4 spots left. And you just need to give me a deposit to hold that spot. Mm-hmm. Yes, ma'am.
Is there a number where we can reach you?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, let's get
oh,
that
yeah,
on
you can
tape.
Give me a call. It's 313-433-4586.
And say that one more time so we can get it in the phone.
313-433-4586. 8:6. This is called the Food of the Gods Tour, or Fruit of the Gods. I prefer Food of the Gods Tour. If you have any Egyptian artwork at home, on some of those, you can see that they have the disc, the mushrooms are being fed to the pharaohs. Because it's only back in those days that the pharaohs would be the ones to eat them. And then what the pharaohs would do in order to stay in power is that they would give their urine to the commoners. And the commoners would drink the urine of the pharaohs who have ingested the mushrooms. And it's like, oh my, oh, he must be the grand, because I drank his pee or whatever this elixir is. And now I'm in this space of gloriness. Now I want to say, okay, I want to say also, let me back up here a little bit. If you take your 5, 7, or 9 and you're coming down, generally it takes about 6 to 8 hours to come down, but you're brave enough and you want to go back up again, it's called recycling. Just drink your urine. You're gone. You're gone. And if you don't know anything about urine therapy, I would suggest that you learn about it, because anything with the word I-N-E on it got somebody pee in it. They have to say visine or murine or anything with ing in it got somebody pee in it. So urea, check it out. Your pee is your own perfect medicine. It's your pee to immortality. Check it out. Mm-hmm. So recycling is a big deal. Okay. Yes.
But if your body's unhealthy, why would that work?
If your body's unhealthy,
yeah.
Well, meaning why would the urine work?
Yeah.
So, I had fibroids, and I started drinking my urine maybe too late while this process was happening, right? Went into the mushrooms, and the mushrooms said, get out of here, don't come back in here sick like this. Because I want to be you, and you get to be me, and I don't want to be in a sick body, being, you know what I'm saying, on this journey. You do have to be careful in recycling, because if you're taking all of these medications, you're double dosing yourself. So you gotta be intellectual about it. I take high blood pressure, I take this, I take that, then don't do it. It's not for everybody. So, and also, you don't wanna be a heavy meat eater. You don't want to drink a lot of alcohol. Foods on a higher vibration. My pee tastes like chicken soup, it's wonderful, you know? You drink your water, but yes, you don't want to double dose. So you do have to be careful. You know, I was on the path to healing these fibroids, but I was bleeding out. And the mushroom was like, you're in a hurry. You need to go handle this. And within 9 days, I was on the surgeon's table getting it handled. In 9 days, I had no insurance. I had no way to do it. I didn't know what was going on, but the mushroom was like, whatever, the doors opened up and I was laying on the table and I was getting fixed. So I give thanks for that energy. Absolutely, but great question. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Do you have an actual Instagram link that talks about the healing trip?
You know what, and I gotta stop this. I'm an OG, so I don't have an IG. Right. I'm tech phobia, I'm working on it. My husband is the one that did all the tech stuff. Okay. But I'm working on it. I do have a Facebook page though.
You
know, Ayana Ife Iye. I'll give you that information and you can just hit me up and befriend you. Yeah. Yeah,
okay,
absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, ma'am.
All right. One more. I'll go with that.
Yeah.
I'm going to say, Ma, this has been incredible. I cried literally during your talk. And I teared up. We welled up.
Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you.